following interview was conducted with Marilyn Haring for the Purdue University Oral History Program. It took place on Wednesday, December 6, 2006, at Stewart Center, Room 263. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the Oral History Librarian. Welcome. Can you tell us a little bit about your early life and where you were born?
I'm a Southwesterner, born and spent my early years in Jerome, Arizona, which is now a ghost town. It was a booming copper mining town for many years. When it closed the mine, it was a Phelps Dodge enterprise, my family moved to Prescott, Arizona. And the strange thing about that was they cut their house in half and moved it on the back of a flatbed truck over a 7,000-foot mountain to Prescott. And it was Prescott where I graduated. And
what, grade school in high school or high
school? From grades 5 through high school.
Okay. Do you remember a little bit, any clubs or any teachers? Do you still keep in touch with any of these people?
I don't keep in touch, but I remember them so vividly. They were so important to me. I think my mother was a very important influence when we lived in Jerome, which truly did not have a lot of cultural advantages, being a mining town. On the side of a mountain where most of the houses were on stilts, in our particular house, we had to keep the front door locked because if we raced out the front door and forgot, there was a 300-foot drop immediately. So, but back to my mother. She did a wonderful thing. She took my brother and me to the library almost every night. And that was a love of learning, of reading, that was instilled in me so early. And I always wanted to do school, and so I became a teacher.
Okay. Is you just have one brother?
He is deceased, but yes, I just have.
Then we went out to college, also in Arizona. Tell us
yes.
about that.
Really did not have enough vision to consider many places to go. I was the first in my family to attend college, and although I was valedictorian of the high school class, I went to what was probably the closest college, Arizona State. And so I'm one of these people who got all of her degrees at Arizona State University. So. There's a little bit of sun devil as well as boiling anchor in me.
Did you continue on grad? Do your graduate right after the undergrad, or did you take a break? Or?
I became a teacher,
okay.
And I
in Arizona.
In Tempe, Arizona, where Arizona State is, as a matter of fact, I was a high school history teacher, and taught not just American history but Southwest history. So that was a wonderful assignment that I enjoyed a lot. I taught for 3 years as I earned a master's degree in guidance and counseling, and then for 3 years I was a school counselor. So I really stayed in that area for quite a long time. Then I went back and earned my doctorate. And strangely enough, although it was not part of their policy, Arizona State hired me as a faculty person. So I felt very fortunate and really enjoyed the various roles I had at Arizona State. Undergraduate, graduate, teaching assistant, I was a faculty wife, and then a faculty member.
How did you view the transition from being a student and staying on at the institution?
I think even as a graduate student, we know a lot of things about what motivate people. Fear of failure motivated me the whole way. So in going back to graduate school in my 30s, I was very concerned that I was not up to the task, and it worked out just fine. But I certainly worried about it. So yes, those changing roles and then to become a faculty member, I remember interviewing with the dean and saying, what does this mean to this College of Education if one of your graduates is hired as a faculty member? And they went all the way to the president of the university to ensure that this was an acceptable thing to do. So I was very fortunate to step into a faculty.
I gather that remark that not very many people had stayed on afterwards. That varies with institutions, though, doesn't it?
It does. In Purdue, for instance, I think tends to hire some of the best of its best, but that was not the case at Arizona State. But that's how I got my start as a faculty member.
Do you ever keep in touch with any of the faculty?
Yes. My major advisor is now living in Florida, happily, and I certainly have her email, and we stay in touch. And one of my office mates, who now lives right next door to the NYU campus, so we visit her often in the village, and sure. So lots of good times.
When you were in, did you live on campus?
Yes, as an undergraduate, okay. I certainly did. Back in those times, you really had to live on campus, that was required, and really, if you were 23, you were allowed to move off campus as an undergraduate, but most of us were typical, traditional age, so it was just a different time.
Yes, I understand. And then did career path took you where, when did you leave Arizona? And
I left, I was on the ASU faculty for a couple of years when my husband, who was a department head and professor,
university.
Yes, he was tragically killed in an auto accident, and so my life had been just perfect, and suddenly it was in disarray. And so after a couple of years, I married an acquaintance of his who was a faculty member at the University of North Carolina in Greensboro. So I never thought I would leave Tempe, Arizona, and I did. I moved to UNC Greensboro, became associate dean there, which was a pretty big leap. I had, at Arizona State, been an untenured assistant professor, so it was an opportunity. And I felt like all of the organizational things that some of us women do, especially women, really served me well in moving into an administrative position.
That's what you did. And then from there, you went, before we get to Purdue, but you came from Massachusetts.
Yes.
Did you go from North Carolina to Massachusetts?
Yes, I did.
There's your career at the threat.
Yes, as a matter of fact, I was very happily ensconced at UNC Greensboro, and a former student of mine from Arizona State nominated me for a deanship, and that just was completely out of the blue, but I'd been an associate dean. So I did not get that job at the University of Vermont, but they referred my name to the pool at the University of Massachusetts at Amherst, and I was selected as dean there. So it was an interesting experience in Arizona, plunked down in Amherst, Massachusetts. It was wonderful.
Quite a change, though, isn't
yes.
it?
Yes. Yeah.
And how did you to come to Purdue then? How did that come?
I was happily ensconced again at the University of Massachusetts. I'm sorry to say I was not an intentional person about my career. But there was this person who kept calling me from Purdue. And literally, on the sixth phone call, I said, I don't know Bruce Scherzer, and I don't know what he wants, but I am going to get him off the line. So I answered the phone, and Bruce was the chair of the search committee. As it turns out, I'd been nominated by an alum who had been in Massachusetts at the same time I was, and was an alum of Purdue. And so at that point, Bruce very cleverly said, we've been thinking about you and screening candidates, and well, we don't want to put any burden on you, but would you just send us your vita? And I thought, sure, this doesn't take any time, and I shipped it off. And about a month later, Bruce called, and he said, well, we've been through this pool twice, and you keep coming to the top. Would you send us a letter? I said, oh, sure. And one thing led to another. I came here during that terrible ice storm of 1991, and I saw this area just beleaguered by this natural tragedy, really. And I still loved it. So I thought I would be at UMass for a very long time, and Purdue really made extra effort to recruit me, and I'm glad I came.
Good. Would your husband come along with you then?
No, that was tragic. He never went to Amherst, and we decided to part ways when I was coming up here. He had been a faculty member, by the way, at Indiana University, so the fact that I was coming to Purdue wasn't exactly a happy matter for that side of the family.
see, what are some of the activities you were involved in being with? One of the things was the curriculum. They made some curriculum changes in their reform. Wasn't that one of the things?
That was one of the best things, I think, that we did. We had programs that had not been revised in 20 years. And the faculty worked so hard, and I can tell you that they were just key points where we needed approvals, and finally those approvals came, and it was just a day of great celebration. We had forward-looking programs so that the next dean could come in and attend to other matters. So I'm very, very proud of the forward-looking elementary education major as an example, and then the teacher preparation part of secondary majors was also revamped in sterling way.
That's good. You about diversity is far greater than what meets the eye. I got a comment that you said. You also have your minority student association. Is that still going in student education?
I don't know. Katie, I'm concerned that it might not be. I never hear a word about it.
Okay.
I had mixed feelings about it. I thought it was very important to encourage all of our students, but by singling out a small group, I wondered if that was the right thing to do. I don't know if it was or not, but I was very proud to support that group.
It was a big, good ongoing thing.
Yes, absolutely.
Now, one of the things that I would like for you to talk about is your reading recovery program, because that's one of the top ones in the country. Should feel very pleased about that.
I'm just thrilled with that.
U.S. News ranks the grad program very high.
Terrific. I didn't know that. Thank you. the way it happened was that I was actually vacationing in Prescott, Arizona, and received a phone call and said, if we are going to do anything with reading recovery, we are going to have to send a person to the University of Illinois to be trained. And that was at a minimum of $50,000. We didn't have the money. And I thought about it and said, this is too important not to do. We will find the money. And so I've at times thought of it as stepping off the curb into traffic without really knowing if I could get all the way across the street. But we had selected certainly the right person, Mary Beth Schmidt. And she's just been given a distinguished chair, and I'm just so proud of her for that. She went there for a whole year. Her family was here in the Lafayette area, and she prepared herself to become, it's a three-tiered model, and she is prepared to be at the very top of that pyramid. And so she would train others to be trainers of teachers. And I believe that through reading recovery, which works with the bottom 20% of first graders who are at risk of never being able to read, and has a phenomenal success record, and the people who are trained as teachers to work with individuals really have great skill. They are analyzing moment by moment how to help this youngster become a skilled reader and an independent reader, as the successful readers we know that the various strategies we use. So that's how we got reading recovery, and aren't we glad?
Might, for the researchers who are going to be sharing the transcript, might just one or two sentences what the reading recovery, so for some people reading this would understand it a little bit better.
Reading Recovery is a program that was begun by Marie Clay in New Zealand, and it is highly researched. It is a program, as I said, for the bottom 20% of first graders at risk of never learning to read. They don't even know that text goes from left to right in the English language, or wouldn't know how to even hold a book the right side up. And 90% of those do become good readers, reading on a par with their cohort. But the training is very specialized, and that's where Purdue comes in. We are the official trainer for the state of Indiana, and we have touched about 50,000 students. And what we all know is how important it is for people to become readers to their success in school in later years. But what it does, it prepares, as I said, for a teacher to work one-on-one with a youngster for 16 to 20 weeks, a half an hour a day. And its goal is to help this youngster acquire the text expertise needed to read independently. And so there are cues that are given students as they are reading. They self-correct after a while. These first graders will make a mistake and they will self-correct themselves. The fact that you take youngsters who are very low performing and raise them up to a grade level is just amazing.
Another thing that you've done over there is the impact of your country technology resources center over there. The
yes.
impact of technology and
yes.
the training of these future teachers.
I sometimes think about the amazing changes since I came in 1991. But we had a couple of professors, Drs. McInerney and Lehman, who were veterans in that they had offered a class online with a chat room kind of environment. And we decided to build on that. And what we wanted to be known for was preparing educational professionals who were really good with technology. So we put it in our strategic plan and did such things as start a distance learning doctoral cohort for people who were already in schools, probably as assistant principals or assistant superintendents and wanted to earn a doctorate. It was the first of its kind here in Indiana, for sure. So we rustled around and found some funding to, instead of having the traditional materials that teachers would ordinarily use, such as construction paper and so forth, we wanted a technology resources center. So we got that established. Again, we found those who would support it with some resources. And it wasn't easy, but we knew it was the right thing to do. So we got ahead of the curve on that one. I'm very blessed to do it.
You got some distant learning. You also got that grant from AT&T for the, which was another one, which was good.
It
that
was
falls into the technology.
Absolutely. AT&T really got us off and running. We established a distance learning classroom, and it was state-of-the-art. And, of course, now it keeps improving. So it was a wonderful turn of events. We didn't get so many contributions that we couldn't say when we received something that just moved us along. We were just jubilant about it.
Things all right. How about student teachers? How's that changing your instruction model, or what are some of the all these things that come into it?
Yes. I think
during your tenure,
one of the legitimate criticisms of teacher preparation is that institutions used to only give their students a practical experience at the end of their preparation. All of the rest of it was in the college classroom, and so it was one semester of student teaching. And then they were put out there on the job market. The faculty obviously knew that this was weak, so when we revamped programs, we designed a series of field experiences that could begin as early as the freshman year and move through sophomore, junior, and senior. And so it's very intensive, especially for an institution the size of Purdue, to find all of these placements that we have out in the community, but it's worth it. I've had so many superintendents say, I don't know exactly what's changed at Purdue, but you have high-quality graduates now, and we just love to hear that, of course.
Has the enrollment increased during all the time?
You know, I think they purposely drew down. At its zenith, we had over 1,400 majors in School of Education, as it was then, and we only had three majors, elementary, special education, and social studies, and then there were another about 1,000 on campus preparing to be secondary teachers. So now, last I saw, we had pulled back to only about 600 majors in the School of Education. And that's consistent with the university's emphasis more on graduate education now. Mm-hmm. So that was planned.
Yeah. Okay.
But business was booming, and we were stretched very thin for a while.
Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about mentoring.
Oh, great. Yes. Okay.
Then we get around to that.
Yes.
Good. Tell us a little bit about just share some reminiscences of mentoring and things.
Yes.
That I think our researchers could benefit by.
I became so interested in mentoring when my own research focused on people in non-traditional careers. And it could be discouraging because those who were newcomers by race or class or gender, whatever, found many barriers in place. And so it logically led me to ask, what could help those who are pursuing non-traditional careers overcome those barriers and prosper in those careers? And, of course, mentoring was a very logical and very positive solution. But as I studied mentoring, the way it has been done is really a model that was developed in business, and it might be called cloning. That is, someone who was well-positioned in the organization would reach out to someone invariably who looked a lot like them and take them under their wing and help them succeed eventually into the position that that more experienced person had. Well, it's flawed, obviously. There's a power differential. There's an emphasis on the hierarchy. And then I began to really be troubled about how many people are left out. Who doesn't get that opportunity? And so there was a group of women administrators in Minnesota, and I had chaired the ones in both Indiana at one time, but also in North Carolina, Women Administrators in Higher Education Administration. And they had published an article about how they had networked and assisted each other so well that they enjoyed many of the benefits that a grooming mentoring relationship might offer. And of course, they didn't have the downsides. What they were talking about was a level playing field in which people were recognized as having many different talents to contribute to others. And it, as it turned out in my research and the research of others, there are certain groups of us who are very collaborative, and so this particular model, networking mentoring, is very well received by us. We can operate in that very, very well. So that led me into the mentoring, and especially into networking mentoring. And across the country, I guess I keep estimating. I should sit down and probably count it, but around 24 mentoring programs I've helped people establish, and it's with students, with new faculty, with new professionals, all sorts of mentoring programs. But my challenge has always been to open the eyes of those who want a mentoring program to the alternative, which is networking mentoring.
Good point. Sorry. Contrast a little bit. You established some mentoring groups from the West Lafayette campus too, didn't you?
Yes.
Are those groups still going?
No, they're not. But we reached out to women on campus, and at one point, Mara Wasburn was also interested in this, and so we joined together. And we had five different groups of women, mainly administrative professionals and clerical and secretarial staff. And I think that it invited people to join together in ways they may not have before.
Did you work with the Council on the Status of Women? Did they do anything?
That's what started it.
Oh, started.
Yes.
Okay.
I think we had a meeting.
Still going, that council.
Yes. And they were very interested in the mentoring piece, and so they called a meeting in which I did an orientation. There were 200 people. I think 195 women and 5 men who wanted to learn and be supported. So it was a wonderful meeting.
I think that probably having been here for a long time, there wasn't, I'm sure it goes on individually or within, but not any sort of program, and it could be also networking. So
cross back and forth.
Absolutely, and I think it's very enriching. Across campus, we have all sorts of people who, because of their jobs or whatever, feel a bit isolated, and so connecting in these networks was really supportive.
Right, I would say so, yeah. And you did get that, one of the awards that she got was the Violet House Recognition Award for her counseling.
Was
that a surprise?
Yes, it was. I was amazed. I'd actually written a letter of support for someone else. And when it was announced, I was just astonished. I'd never thought of myself as perhaps worthy of that. I just didn't think of
that. That's fair. Choice. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Now, one of the things that the College of Education hosts is the Crystal Apple Award.
Yes.
And tell us a little bit about that, and also for the researchers that it's been going for some time. And I believe Emily Mobley was she on the committee at one time or not?
I don't recall that.
But I remember her talking about a little bit of it, yeah.
Well, let me tell you how it got started. Yeah. Barbara Francis was our development director. And we are able to recognize people in a variety of ways, such as honorary doctorates or distinguished alums. But she wanted to be able to have the contributors, that is, funding, the people who contributed to our school, to have the opportunity at maybe a little different level to say, I've worked with this teacher who is so outstanding. And so it would be to find a different pool of very, very worthy people. And so the way it worked and does work is that contributors of a certain amount of money are given the opportunity to nominate someone to receive a crystal apple. And so it's a very personal one-to-one relationship, and it recognizes people who might not ordinarily be recognized by a university. And it's one of the most gratifying evenings of recognition that the school or now the college has. It's really heartwarming to hear from those who nominated and those who received those crystals. Yeah.
And it's not for Purdue, it's for non-Purdue, correct?
Yes. Whoever they chose to
nominate. So in other words, Purdue could...
They could be graduates of Purdue,
okay.
But it is up to the individual who contributed to the support of the school to say, this is a person who is a significant educator, someone who I have recognized, and now I want to do it formally.
Okay. Let me talk about partnerships. You've got some established partnerships within the school corporations here in
Yes.
with Lafayette, I think.
Yes. We had a number of professional development schools. It's changed a little bit now, but it came from our being a charter member, and I think the faculty has been very proud of that, of a group called the Holmes Group. And it is research universities, colleges of education, and they have a very important agenda, we felt. One was to partner collaboratively with schools to enrich our preparation, to enrich our research, and at the same time to focus our resources on certain schools who wanted to try some new things or whatever. So that was part of the Holmes Group agenda, and we worked very closely with about a half dozen. It's been expanded now by the current administration so that professional development school is now any school that hosts any of our practical experiences. So the list is very impressive. There are about 50 schools that do host, whether it's student teachers, or it might be school counseling interns, or it might be those early field experiences. But it's important that Purdue reach out in ways that are collaborative. And certainly when I came here, the community was sending a message, we want to see you out in our schools. And the faculty have done that very well.
That's very good. Okay. Now, when you step down as dean, I've missed the everyday contact with students. I'll be closer to students, and those are both prizes as far as I'm concerned. That's a very good comment.
Thank you.
A little about the students and your contact, which you've kept on always.
Yes. I've been so privileged to work with graduate students in two programs since I stepped down as dean, or stepped away from the deanship, however you choose to see it. One group is school counseling graduate students who are preparing to be school counselors. And I've supervised their internship, so I get to go out to the schools where they're doing their work. And often these are schools where, as dean, I had many opportunities to interact. But it's shaping those school counseling professionals' experiences in ways that I think are extremely important. They're terrific young people. And I meet them every week. I go out to their sites three times during the semester. I listen to their tapes. And it's really synergistic relationship. I have drawn so much from that, and I certainly hope that they have too. So that's one group. The other group is a program that was inspired by Ken Burns and myself and Judy Gappa getting together, and it was that higher education graduate students often are full-time employees at the university. They are staff administrators of one sort or another, maybe the business managers for a particular unit. And we created among us and successfully carried out what was called a specialization in business and finance management. And so we've had many of the Purdue University staff go through the program. And of course, these are colleagues, very much so. I had dealt with them in their respective roles when I was dean, and now to work with them as a facilitator is how I would say it. I regarded and highly respected each and every person in those classes as a resource. So when the program was being designed, there were a few odds and ends of curriculum, and I recall the day we discussed, well, really, administrators should have a course in facilities and space management. And we looked at each other and said, well, we don't think that's taught anywhere. Who would teach it? And suddenly there were four eyes directed at me. And that was a real trip. I developed an experience, put it that way, in which we had administrators involved in space and management, the university architect, head of environment and safety, and so forth. They would come in and be a resource, and then, of course, the members of the class were a wonderful resource. So, again, that synergy, doing new things that I never dreamed I would have the opportunity to do. As I said earlier, I'm a teacher at heart.
That's right, exactly.
Let me tell you about one other. See, you're going to have a hard time turning me off. The other course I'm just finishing this semester, one-time offering, but it's problem solving and decision making in higher education administration. And I have just had a ball with it. We've had 16 brave souls who came into it. We have studied problem solving, decision making models. We've applied it in case studies. But now, each of the four teams, I do a lot of teamwork, invited in two administrators to discuss how they solve problems and make decisions. And so we had four last week, and we're having our final four this week. It's been really exciting. It's just, these are conversations that we would never have had. And what we're hearing from our guests who come in for an hour at a time is that they would never have had the opportunity to really analyze how they went about their business. It has been a blast.
That's good. What are your retirement plans?
Okay. Well, let's just start with one of our recent topics.
Yes.
I believe I'll have an opportunity. I've been asked by the Mellon Foundation, after being invited to a very small conference that they had. They've asked me now to do some more work with them on evaluating mentoring programs, and especially networking mentoring programs. What's happening? What's good? What can we even improve on? But the initial invitation just came out of the blue, and it was from some people who had been reading things I'd had in various journals. And it was a meeting of those that had Mellon Mentoring Undergraduate Fellowship trainings, MMUMT. And these, the purpose of their programs, and they put a lot of money into it, is mentoring those who will add diversity to the professoriate. And so it is mentoring undergraduate students who are underrepresented, as well as graduate students, with the aim toward, very much like the libraries, I think, diversity fellowships, aiming toward academia. So this small conference was called by Mellon. It was held at Brown University, and it was only Brown, Princeton, Oberlin, and the University of Southern California, and then this person who dropped in from Indiana, of all places. But I think they really appreciated hearing that it didn't have to be a one-on-one match, because matches are fraught with peril. Sometimes it just doesn't work. But there was an alternative, and that was the network. So I'm looking forward to professionally continuing with that. I also review for an ALA publication for academic librarians called Choice. And I review books on mentoring for academic librarians to consider if they want to add to their collections. So that will be fun to keep my hand in that. But where will I do this? Well, I have two retirement homes, and the first one I will go to as I move from West Lafayette is at Niagara-on-the-Lake in Ontario, Canada, home of a festival of plays, a Shaw-era festival that I've enjoyed for probably the last dozen years. So I bought a home there a few years ago and was always headed toward Niagara-on-the-Lake for at least part of the year. But the rest of the year, I get to return to my beloved Southwest. I have a home in Santa Fe, New Mexico that I bought in the early 90s. And I just so thoroughly enjoy the culture there. It's precious. It's hard to even express it. But it will be certainly a contrast. Niagara-on-the-Lake is doing plays and so forth, primarily by Anglo-Saxon types. And then I get to go to Santa Fe and be surrounded by diverse peoples with diverse cultures, perceptions, ideas. For me, it's heaven.
Great. Now I've got to try one. What would you consider an outstanding event in your life? You got anything that sticks in your mind?
Gosh.
Well, you shared a lot of things today. Yeah. You probably would go into that, too.
Well, I would say, for me, my style, who I am, my values, that some of the highlights of my life have been vicariously enjoying the triumphs of people that I've supported. Academics who, for instance, I mentioned the one who just received a distinguished chair. I just feel that it's so important to enable others to be as successful as they can be. So there's a whole list of those. Let me see if there's anything else. I guess I feel honored to have been at the universities where I've been. I never dreamed I would have an opportunity to be at this world-class institution, Purdue University. I never dreamed I would live, even for just the short 3 years before Purdue came calling, in Amherst, Massachusetts. And then North Carolina was a very different slice. So I feel like the goddess or fates or whatever you believe in has smiled upon me. It's been a wonderful life. A little kid running up and down the hills of Jerome, Arizona for fun. We'd round up wild burros and ride them. Who could have guessed that I would have this charmed life? It's beyond words.
Lots of good reminiscences. This is really good. Anything you want to add? One of the things that I've been asking our researchers, you know this is going to be turned over to the archives and special collections. Anything on preservation or archival, any comment? Have you noticed changes over time? People seem to be more concerned about it.
Yes. I'm very impressed that there is this movement underway here at Purdue. I've heard little notes about, from time to time, about people who preceded me here at the university, and I think to really have archives that document who they are or were in terms of what they did, what their values were, what were spectacular accomplishments, well, I think that's a tremendous contribution.
And it enhances the university for people that are going to come after.
It does, and I would see this as being an enrichment that might really help some people understand Purdue, appreciate it, and maybe even want to come here, although, like me, I didn't know much about it. I should have. My father was born in Indiana, and then I just found out my grandfather was born in Indiana. Who would have guessed? So, let me tell you about a couple of accomplishments in the School of Education that I'm very proud of.
Good.
When I came here, when I came here, as you know, education for the most part is dominated by women, and yet the faculty of the School of Education was only one-third women. And by the time I finished my work as dean, we had over 50% women. And so we were moving in the right direction. And we also did the same thing in hiring diversity, and that was we had 3% of underrepresented peoples, whether it was by race, ethnicity, disability, whatever. And we were able to get up to 15%. And that's, in the world of academia, that's going in the right direction. So I'm really pleased about that. And we did it by hiring the very best people. I would not permit a search to continue to the point of inviting candidates to campus until they pool that from which they wanted to invite candidates included women and other underrepresented people, and they had risen there because of their talents and their expertise. And once they had their opportunity to come to Purdue and to demonstrate their strengths, we were able to hire many of them. I'm proud of that.
Anything else you want to add on what you've been doing? But it's nice that you're going to be continuing on. And you keep in touch with the students all the time.
Oh, yes. And one of the nice parts is I will at least be able to keep my Purdue email address for a while. And so as they ask, well, how can we reach you? You're moving away. And it should be easy enough. So.
I also want to add, this wraps it up, but I want to tell Valerie Yazza, our diversity fellow person, who's also sitting in on it. We appreciate that.
Yes.
Do you want to make any comment, Valerie? Do you have anything you want to ask her?
No, it's just really great to hear your background.
Oh, thank you.
We've moved all over the place. Yeah. All the accomplishments.
Well, this girl in pigtails in Jerome, Arizona, saw some ways that she could move, and she did. And lots of people helped. But it should give everybody some encouragement.
We really very much appreciate you taking the time to do this.
Well,
this means a lot to us. Okay.